Be here to speak about open innovation. From my perspective, I basically fell in love with open innovation some 5-6 years ago, more or less after the initial book by Henry Chesbrough came out. And ever since then, I have been doing practical things with the companies, but also quite a bunch of academic work on open innovation through ISPIM, for example, which I'm standing here on behalf of. Let me start. For a few questions, I was actually waiting that maybe Carlos would take this usual stuff on open innovation, but you didn't, so I have a great privilege to ask this question. Do you have all smart people interested in open innovation right now, right here in this room? So raise your hand. Wonderful. So you fully agree with me. Excellent. Would we have a chance that there's one smart person who didn't make it here in time, or maybe it's just by some other reasons didn't show up here? I think it's quite highly likely. So that's one of the reasons why we need open innovation. We cannot rely on our own internal resources in the field of open innovation. We need to find out all these smart people outside of our organization, outside of our conference, outside of the context that we usually do on our daily business. We need to go beyond usual suspects, as it's called in a terminology of open innovation. A little bit about my background on open innovation from the practical side. I've been working with large companies and small companies. One example of a large company is Nokia, and especially Nokia themselves. We did a research project some 5 years ago when we basically created a system how to recycle. That's kind of a demand for the project, how to recycle ideas, how to recycle so-called research surplus portfolio, because it's a big organization, big company, and they create a lot of stuff, because they have a huge research department, and not all the ideas, not all the patents, not all the technologies are bought by business units. So we did a research surplus portfolio model, how to manage these ideas, how to commercialize those ideas outside. What comes to ISPIM, International Society for Professional Innovation Management, we have been also working quite intensively on open innovation, like in 2006 when we held a conference in Warsaw, our annual conference. The topic was about open innovation, so it was really interesting to see all these 400 people, academics, business people, consultants in the conference, exchanging ideas on open innovation and especially how to implement open innovation in a good manner. Also, one very recent highlight good example on open innovation, we had a ISPIM symposium last December in Quebec City in Canada, and there was also on a parallel another conference or track called Quebec Seeks Solutions, basically for companies who must renew themselves to create new business. And one example of that symposium was a company, a manufacturing company, which was basically next to the bankruptcy and was desperately looking for ideas. And just through that conference, they got a beautiful idea. Now the company is back on track and back in business again. So I think that's in briefly what I would like to say here in the opening, and I would like to have a very fruitful discussion on all of this. Thank you.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Anastasia. I've been presented, and even the open program that we have in Portugal, Telecom, I will briefly present what we have with other companies, because it has been said already, and I think it's well known that we work, it's like cultural from a lot of years that we work with startups and small companies. But I will talk a little bit about our internal open program, the thing that I'm going to share today. So we have divided our innovation in three main time frames. It's the incremental, that is less than 1 year, the planned, between 1 and 3 years, and the exploratory. And we manage and we have to be sure that we have projects running in all the three time frames. So we have the diversification of the projects and the investments we are doing. to allow to have permanently arriving the new ideas, the new products and services when we need. How do we generate ideas for each of these time frame frameworks? I'm going to talk the planned and the exploratory are the ones where we involve more the top management and the very well planned dynamics. And after we involve all the community, we involve the suppliers, the partners, all the companies that work with us. The participation in events like this one is exactly to see how the market is looking for new things, what new things are around, to be sure that we are working always in the new way. For the incremental part, that's where we launched the open program. And the open program came to finish a lot of myths we have within the company. Because we have this more open innovation with the other, with the society, than we have within the company. So we have this myth that because we have PT Innovação and we have a lot of departments of engineer, everybody thought, okay, innovation is for the engineer department, it's for R&D, it's only for products, it's only for technology. It's not the like the youngest people that come to have the right ideas. And the first thing, we made a huge communication program to be sure that these myths were not in people's heads. So we had an incredible involvement of the CEO and all the top management. We had more than 350 people doing the training of the other 8,500 that were in sessions having training about this, how you can innovate in all your daily tasks, how can you, think out of the box. Don't think that innovation is R&D and technology. It can be ways of work, it can be management practices, it can be products, and it can be services. All this training had a lot of outcome. We launched the Idea Market, and the Idea Market it's like a platform where everybody can put the ideas. But how does it work? We launch challenges. The challenges we launch are the open strategy that we put to all companies. Let me say that if you look to the 10 challenges that we launch, they are exactly the 10 market and the operational challenges we have in the company. So we don't have this strategy closed in the top management, but we have the strategy open to every employee in the company. How can we solve this specific problem? That is a problem that we are struggling to increase the market share in this specific population. And we are very clear, we keep brief the context, so everybody can think about it, everybody can discuss. And actually in this market we have the comments, and the comments are like an internal blog where you have thousands and thousands of participations of everybody discussing these problems, because somebody puts an idea and after the other people comment. So we have here it's like our crowdsourcing internally. And this is really something that creates an energy that people participate and still participate. And it's like something that you thought, okay, you launch this and after it will die. But it's something that is very, very, very alive. There's a lot of life there because the discussions and the blogs. That's our heart, where people can talk and can receive the answers of the top management and can really discuss the ideas to the company. Everybody today knows what are our challenges, our strategical challenges. And let me tell you that the open is the open of strategy, it's the open of the idea selection, because after we have this market, so everybody can put the opens is like the money of the market, and the opens can make the ideas go up or down in the market, and the ideas that are more voted in the market, that where people make more investments, are the ideas that stay, that are in the good position to be implemented afterwards. They will be discussed in the board, and the person that gives the idea will participate in the implementation afterwards. That's the part of the, we open the implementation to the people that is in the company to implement the ideas afterwards. So what was the result, what did we create with this? One important result that we have almost everybody in the company went at least once to the market, and we have more than 3,000 like permanent users that go there and come and put ideas. We have more than 3,000 ideas approved, and we are like in the one or two. We have 70 ideas in the implementation, and people see that the ideas are discussed and are implemented. And we have one result that is, it's not direct, but we have much more involvement, much more engagement of the people. So one of the instruments we use in the management within the company is the internal survey to see how employee satisfaction is evolving. And the last 3 years, we were less than the participation in this inquiry, in this answering the questionnaire was less than half, and now we have more than 80% of the people answering the questionnaire, and more, and the satisfaction increased a lot. So people is much more engaged. And all the questions about strategy, about the company, about, they are clearly involved, clearly engaged with the company strategy. I think that's probably it's not only the ideas that can across, but it's the energy that you create in the company, the involvement you create in the different people in the company. Okay, thank you.
Once upon a time, we were also a startup in a sector, software sector. And if you look at Microsoft, it's really, when you are inside Microsoft, you understand that Microsoft, in some ways, it's really a bunch of startups. Some are really big startups, but some are very, very small startups. And any new product that comes to the market in Microsoft usually starts within a startup, internally. You know, Kinect. That huge success we have right now, probably an expected success, started as a small startup. I'm not here to talk to you about Microsoft. I'm here to talk to you about the programs that we have to support, that support startups. Microsoft startups and innovation. Microsoft has a strong tradition of working with new companies in the software and other sectors, and we are currently running a set of programs. Some of them have a good expression here in Portugal. I will talk about two or three of them, and one is probably unknown for most of you, I think, which is that we have a program called Microsoft Innovation Center, which is something we do with universities, or usually within the incubation centers at the universities. And it's kind of a joint agreement between Microsoft and the university or the incubation to help startups that are really a fruit of the innovation within the university, to in Portugal we have one Microsoft Innovation Center that's actually working within ISCTE in Lisbon, and we are looking forward having further Microsoft Innovation Center centers in other cities in Portugal. The other program that we have, and it's a quite successful program, and I think probably some of you here have heard about it. It's a program called BizSpark, and BizSpark is really a support program for companies that are in the area of developing software products or services. What we do with these startups it's really to give them access to all the technology that Microsoft produces now, and that means both software and now the cloud platform. So if a startup is now beginning their journey building a new product, especially if that product can be based on a cloud infrastructure, not only we give them for free, no strings attached, so the old software that within our platform, but we also can give them access, again, with no charges, to the hosting platform within the cloud for up to 3 years. And that's probably a very interesting offer. We have been seeing a lot of interest from startups. We are now in Portugal supporting over 200 startups in the software area, which is, I think it's a significant number. Some of these projects have been recognized recently on international startup competitions. The support we give, it's not only on software. We try and we understand fully that a startup is more than just software. And it needs also some partnerships to help them grow. So we have partnered with a number of business incubators and venture capital and other financing organizations to help them, to help these companies have the full support. We call it the partners that are working with us, the BizSpark network partners. So Carlos has just turned the clock. So, I mean, that's a good sign for me. Okay, so I will bow to the pressure. Okay, but I will still be here during the discussion and during lunch if you're interested. So I will be most glad to talk with you. Thank you very much. Usually the companies start always to explain what they do. I will not do such a thing here, but just to explain you why this I will advise you, if someone here didn't saw one very important conference or TED talk conference made by Simon Sinek, I will advise you to see it, because of the process of thinking of what companies do. Because usually companies in the market do explain themselves by what they do, how they do it, and why. I always share that in any innovation process, you have always to start by the why. Why are you here? Why are you in the market? Why you are trying to create a company that can be successful, or can be good at what they do. You can start always by the what, but not by the what directly, but what you are not doing. That's always good to explain to the market. You can start by that. But if you don't start with a passion, with the why, I don't believe that we can innovate in anything, because that's what innovation is about. It's about the passion to solve problems, to do good things, and to not be a negative to any process or any organization. It's about how you solve any kind of problem. We also start by doing the analysis in all the processes that we do for innovation, usually not inside the company, but by listening to customers, by listening to the market. And I would say for a small company that most of the times you are not innovating inside your office, but outside with customers. Because when you listen to the problems, when you listen to the day-to-day life, then you have the ability to, in the business process, with your teams, with all the people, to, in that moment, innovate. Because it's that moment where the light is on, where you get the spark, and you get the spark to understand how to solve a problem. It's not on the office, not on internal discussion, usually for small companies. We all start by the clarification of the process, start by the simplification, and later on the identification process. That's the key thing. Also, just to make a short introduction, also advise you to see a very important presentation that I think is always good to see about innovation people, because innovation is made by people. So it's if you have people that is charismatic enough to do it, it's always good to follow their steps. And I will advise you to see the Stanford presentation made by Steve Jobs, because it's always about connecting the dots, and he explained that very, very well. And at the end, innovation is always about how he ends the presentation by stay angry and stay foolish in everything you do in life, in a very mature way, of course. I will make it short and keep going with the panel.
Thank you.
So we just heard why large companies, or reasons but why large companies acquire startups and small companies, because they really do open innovation as a default. It's the only way to survive, is really to work very closely with customers and with partners to innovate. This is Vitor is also stressing the importance of why we do things and not just the what. We also heard Anna Diaz talking about a very interesting process and methodology of open innovation inside a big corporation with tools, the idea market, which is a kind of a stock exchange for ideas, which makes really not only open innovation in the company, but also the company more open for the employees. As we've heard, there's a different environment with inside the company with this project. Also, Henrik told us a bit about programs and tools that a large company can offer to small companies and to startups so that they can have an easier entry to markets. And Marco told us a bit about what the International Society for Professional Innovation does, and I'll start by you, Marco. So what do you think are the biggest challenges for large companies and large corporations to be successful in their open innovation programs?
I would say one of the biggest challenges definitely for large companies is to go beyond usual suspects, because large companies, although they do a lot of networking, a lot of cooperation with other companies, but usually you on your daily business, you cooperate with the same companies, the same suppliers, same customers, more or less. And the idea, underlying argument behind open innovation is that you're supposed to go beyond usual suspects. You need to really identify
case of the success of the implementation that you are doing on open innovation inside PTE?
Yes, I think one very important thing is that people feel that it's really open. It's not like something that it's put there only to engage people. It's like what it is. It's company's truth that is put in the market. And after, I think one important thing for sure is people seeing recognition. It's not awards, it's not prizes, it's the recognition that somebody is listening to the ideas and if they are good, they are being implemented. And the other thing is that the ideas that came out of the market have to be good ideas, otherwise it's not credible to maintain ideas that are not really.
Do you have any real example of some product that we might be hearing?
Not really,
from this process.
Yeah, the main improvements we have received from the market are, as you said, incremental. That's exactly the target that we launched the challenges within the company. It's incremental, but it can be product and service for sure. So far, we have no product and service, but we have improvements in product and service, for example, implemented. I'm talking about the implementations. The ideas we have, we have a lot of product and service. I'm talking the implemented ideas. We have operational, very important operational in the mail, operational improvements. So the people that is in the field, and that's very what you're saying about the people that knows the client, that knows the problems. The people that were in the field, they realize that somebody said, okay, if you have a number, a serial number that can identify each of the components, so we can make much more easily the maintenance afterwards. And it was implemented, and it improved a lot the repairment time of the bottle.
That's a good example. Victor, you alluded a bit about the value of this open innovation coming, so the collaboration of startups and big corporations in bringing new products and new ideas to market. Can you be a bit more specific on what's the value for your company of working with a large company from a value perspective, a value creation perspective, and also from a mutual benefit, not only for you but also for the customer?
It's a little bit difficult to do it without talking about myself, but trying to be commercial, trying not to be so commercial. It's basically, in whole, when you start a campaign, we start with a strong focus on trying to simplify the processes that we need for a new perhaps, we're establishing big campaigns. And in everything we do, if it's not easy enough to start, we don't do it. That's the first thing. And at the beginning, quick processes and quick win-wins for customers, for big corporations, is always a plus. If you can sit with someone from marketing, from IT, for any area of importance of a company, and explain that in the next day they can solve the problem, and they can do it very quickly, and they don't need to be involved in the huge processes that are typical and normal and natural in big companies, then you are being involved, because you are doing some sort of and freshness to the processes that sometimes are not simplified, not because they can't, but because the companies are too involved with achieving the machine and the process itself. So this possibility to bring freshness and bring some parallel ideas, it's always good for big companies, because I think that's the most important thing that big companies can gain from the small companies.
And from the value perspective of your business, how do you get value which is not only the next month's revenues? So is there IP or things that you can create and can keep with these collaborations? Or
yes, for sure. Because as a company, we do two things. We have a very precise way of entering a company. And the first thing is, to have the quick wins. And with these quick wins, we start explaining how we can do more than bring functionalities, because if you just bring functionalities, you are find in the offers that you bring that you are extending the value in terms of intelligence that you are heading to the companies. And that's what we do in the long term. We start by always getting the trust, getting the quick wins, and in the middle of the process, we only then we share the proposal, the products and services that demands for each commitment. But it's always about trust and quick wins. It's if you do it, it's always easy.
Thank you. Microsoft is known for nurturing an ecosystem of partners and building business together. So I don't know the figure, but maybe you can tell us. For each dollar that Microsoft sells, there's a lot of dollars that are made by partners. So around 10, so it's a huge contribution to other companies. So what part of that contribution goes to startups and to companies that are creating? And a part of the tools, what other things is Microsoft doing, part of buying companies, to assist those companies to be successful?
Okay. So the answer is about our ecosystem. So what I just talked about startups, but we have already established companies that we work with. They were once startups. They created the product. They are now our partners. They are selling their software locally. What we do with most of these companies, and more what we try to do as Portuguese, I mean, and I'm talking about our Portuguese subsidiary, we look at the companies that have the potential to grow outside Portugal. So one of the things that we try to do here is to open international markets for our partners. And I think that's really one of the added values that a multinational company can give to local companies. It's to give them scale. What the other thing we are doing now with the startups, it's we try to nurture them to up to the point that they can become full companies. They can grow up to, and we have these people can stay within this part program while they are while companies can stay before 3 years, during 3 years, or before getting up to $1 million of revenue. So, I mean, after that, we say you are not a startup anymore if you have revenue of more than $1 million. So, I mean, so the spec is very broad. And after that, we try to bring these companies. So we have a graduation offer, which means we fully integrate within our partner ecosystem. And then again, try to give them as much exposure to the market as possible, local market, international market.
Thank you, Eric. So now we go into a more interactive session. Hopefully, I know that lunch is just 15 minutes away, but we'll only end at, our lunch only will be served after several questions have been done by the audience. So who's the first volunteer to do a question about to the panel about this subject? So the name of the TED Talk is
Simon Sinek, and the talk is How Great Leaders Inspire Action. I really recommend you to watch it.
More questions? Okay, there's one. Microphone.
A lot of new ideas, information, and that's also to give an answer.
mechanism of the stock market helps a lot. The two things, the stock market, because it's the community of employees that participates in the market that makes the selection. And after, you give a quick look, but you're going to look exactly for the ideas that are approved by the market. So this is, you can say, okay, but you can use some good ideas, that's true, but that's something that helps you to make a selection and much more, you see the ideas that are much more elaborated in the end. And the stock market and the commons, if you see that's like a crowdsourcing working around, because the discussions about the ideas makes people after putting more opens or not in the idea, so that's something that is working. It's a market, it's not the perfect, but it's a market, and it helps to do it. And we are planning actually to open this project markets to the community. We're going to start with the academies in the next months, and the idea is to open to the community exactly to see how can we work with the community, with the market. And the market is the filtering that we use.
I think that's a very good question, and you should definitely hit the point about how to be open and invite people to bring ideas in and try to manage that in a properly. I will give you one example from VTT, which is the Finnish partly government-owned research organization, and some years back in time they invited all the Finns by asking questions, how to use mobile phones. And they had this campaign for 2 weeks, and within 2 weeks they got 44,000 ideas. And I know this person responsible for this project, and basically 2 years after he has been still going through those ideas, 44,000 ideas, it creates a big headache for a person who is responsible for that. So you should ask right questions. Be very precise what you actually ask for the people to contribute, otherwise it's a big mess. Although there are some technologies which may help you to do this kind of pre-selection, like the semantic web or web 2.0 solutions, which somehow helps you to clarify what's going on, but still you need a quick reward system or some kind of appreciation for people who actually contribute to your idea funnel.
More questions?
Isn't that the name that the idea that came out from the market or the selection system to the board, and finally the board says, well, the system is not giving, outputting the good ideas? Isn't the conflict between the decision makers and finally who decide to invest and the system, the automatic system or the collaborative system?
Of course, we have a filter of a team that looks to the outcome of the market and looks to the ideas that are being rejected by the market. But the ideas are not, they don't go exactly as they are in the market to the board. They are working with the people, with the person that give the idea to make a project that makes sense. And if it's not, it doesn't make sense, we talk to the people and we explain why. But of course, we had ideas like give more 20% of the salary to everybody. We have, that's something that we manage talking with people. It's like it's open. You talk.
More questions?
And startups work together is extremely important because, of course, the fundamentals are right. Big companies need to learn from small companies. The small companies can only get the sales and implementation power if they work with large companies. But what I see in reality is that in Europe, we spoke about so many times this morning, is fragmented. Big companies are the only larger business organizations that can go beyond that fragmentation. So I see, you know, France Telecom doing a lot of stuff in France, and I see Deutsche Telekom doing a lot of things in Germany. These are in their own right very big companies, like the Porsche or Ericsson, etc., etc. So, what's the secret here of being more effective across the borders? Because talent, innovation, technology has no borders.
We think. I mean, we work every day on the thinking, spreading the news about these startups across the borders. So we have our local offices which work locally and nurture the local startups. But we keep in touch almost, I think, almost every day to promote our startups, our local startups on a global level. So we have a central marketing organization within a region just for startups. I think which is probably not, I don't know if other global companies have this, but we have a lot of regional centers just to promote startups and the innovation they bring to the market. Okay. So it's quite, it's a process. I mean, it's not just something that came out of the box. It was being built out of the difficulties that we felt. So we kept improving the process, and right now it's kind of a machine. So if you are a startup, you are in a program. So we have a program that where you can show yourself up. You become, I would say, a startup of the day. So you are promoted throughout all the network partners within the program, and we have also kind of a marketing organization within Microsoft just to promote your case outside. I mean, so that's quite effective.
So a few words. I think that was also a wonderful question. Ideas have no border and money never sleeps. And it's more or less about the company culture, which kind of culture you implement, whether you are truly open innovation company and you have this kind of culture which is related to your business model. If you change your business model to us more open, then borders doesn't really matter that much, and you can actually then get rid of not sold here, not invented here syndromes and organizational inertia, which is always like you just try to set up the limits and borders.
Just a small comment. We don't look only for Portuguese companies. For sure, the companies that come to us are much more likely to be Portuguese. But it's not an issue. So this is a message more to the small companies too. So make yourself present to the big companies, because there's no that issue. And I can tell you that we work more, for example, with the Israeli companies than with the European companies. And they are far, but they, you know, when they came and they present, and that's not the issue. We want good ideas, we want people that align with our business strategy, and we work with them. They have to be good, they have to add value. That's something that's very important, what you said before. But there's no border issue, but we don't have a proactive way to go outside the
country. Also, sharing the experiences. And of course, there is no formula for it. There are several. As a company, from day one, we decided to do one thing that is a little bit risky, and most of the people said to us, when you grow a little bit, you'll change your mind. But we defined that we wanted to be in our core of the company, not bigger than 12%. And 3 years later, and growing in the market, we still kept that number in our heads. Because for us, this is the only way to do it. To keep the flexibility and keep the innovation levels that we believe that we need to put in the market. With this in mind, of course, it's very difficult to grow, because sometimes you have to learn to do one of the most difficult things for companies. I would say for Portuguese companies, probably more than for other companies, that stability to say no to the market we decided that we could go internationally, we start talking with the companies, with big companies outside, and without the strength of being Portuguese, being small, being everything. And right now we have service in 10 countries, we are expanding in Spain, going to Brazil, and sometimes of course we have the big companies asking us, how many people are you? This is not a problem when you are talking in Portugal. If you go to big European companies, maybe. If you go to the United States, then you have a problem. Because if you say we are 8 persons, you say you are not trustable as a company. And when I say 12 persons, and they say the same, I always make a joke. It's we are in the information era, everybody is saying that. Everything is growing a lot, very dynamically. 2,000 years ago, someone had made a lot with 12 persons. And maybe right now we can do the same, maybe more. So there are no limits for it. There are no limits for what you can do, how you can think, how you can present yourself. So,
William, it's a final just comment.
Thank you very much for these very interesting comments. And I really believe this is a very important topic, not only for society, but also for companies, big companies, by the way. Because you have seen IBM, Cisco, IBM is launching C-Camp, it's a global competition for startups. Cisco is launching iPrize. The prize is we want to build with you the next $1 billion business for Cisco. By the way, of course, it's powered by collaboration software of Cisco. This shows that Cisco is betting, for example, big, Cisco, but it's a big business for the future to bet on collaboration. So for Cisco apparently big enough that it's acquiring companies in this space. So corporate venturing is not something nice to have, I think it will be a must have for companies. And also governments must think, like there's no more one model for corporate venturing. Governments, there's not one model for how governments can help in this process, but probably there's definitely need for more research, for more initiatives, for checking, you know, for learning in the market how this is working, because I really believe that also for big companies, survival is at stake. And companies that are doing well will do well for the future.
Thank you, William, and just wrapping up, so I think it's clear from this panel that cooperation between big companies and the SMEs benefits for sure the consumer and the end customers. The value for SMEs is around scaling, expansion, and fast growth, and of course revenues. And I'd say depending on how IP is created and the products are created, it could be also an evaluation for a future trade or for a future sale. For the big companies, the flexibility that sometimes they don't have can be acquired by acquiring these companies or just by partnering with these smaller companies that think out of the box and that do things faster. So I'd like to thank the panel for being here and all of you.